Among all cancers, cancer of the bone is a relatively lesser known entity. What is bone cancer? What are its symptoms? Why is it that it has happened to my loved one? What causes bone cancer? And above all, what are the chances of cure if someone has been diagnosed with this disease? Hello everyone, welcome to Bone Cancer Clinic Chandigarh, an exclusive orthopedic oncology clinic. I am Dr. Rajat Gupta, orthopedic oncologist, and in this video, I'll be talking about frequently asked questions on bone cancer, its symptoms, treatment, chances of cure, etc. For more information, you can log into our website www.curebonecancer.com. So to answer the first question as to what is bone cancer, it is a malignant tumor of the bones which can spread to lungs or other parts of the body. It's of two types, primary bone cancer, which arises from the bone itself and has a tendency to spread to other parts of the body. It's commonly seen in children and adolescents. Common examples include osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma. Chondrosarcoma is another primary bone cancer which has tendency to occur in adults and elderly population. Second type is secondary bone cancer. In this, cancer has spread to the bones from some other part of the body like breast, lung, kidney, etc. It's commonly seen in the elderly population. This is the most common type of bone cancer and is also called bone metastasis or metastatic bone disease. Another common query is, what are the symptoms of bone cancer? Well, the most common symptom is pain, which over time gets worse and continuous. In addition, any known patient of cancer, like cancer of the breast, thyroid, etc., if that patient develops pain in these bones, it may be a hallmark of the cancer spread to the bones. In addition to pain, patient may also complain of swelling of the involved region, which keeps on increasing with time. Many a times, more commonly in children, the patient may attribute these symptoms to any prior trivial trauma, like being hit by a football while playing, etc. Moreover, bone cancer causes weakening of the bone, making it prone to fracture without any trauma or with minor trauma like fall from the bicycle or twisting injury to the knee while playing routine sports. So sometimes a patient may present to the clinician just with the history of fracture without any significant trauma. This kind of fracture is called pathological fracture. In advanced stages, patient may present to us with unintentional weight loss or loss of appetite. Now coming to the most common question which everyone asks me is as to what leads to cancer of the bones. As of now, there are no environmental or hereditary factors known to cause cancer of the bones. However, certain patients who have received prior radiation therapy or patients with certain genetic alterations, they are more predisposed to development of these kind of bone cancers. Another common question is, how do we diagnose cancer of the bones? A patient suspected to have a bone cancer is subjected to a battery of tests which include X-ray, MRI, PET CT and so on. A plain X-ray tells us about the location of the lesion in the bone, whether it's at the growing ends of the bone called as the epiphyses, whether it's in the shaft of the bone called as the diaphyses, or whether it's located in the area in between epiphyses and diaphyses called as metaphyses. In addition, it also tells us about the type of lesion in the bone, whether it is bone eating lesion, that is lytic lesion, or bone forming lesion, that is sclerotic lesion. In the given X-ray, we can see there is a lytic lesion in the metaphyses of the thigh bone. In addition, X-ray also tells us about any obvious or impending fracture. After X-ray, the patient is subjected to the MRI of the bone so as to look for the extent of the lesion, the involvement of any surrounding muscle, nerves, blood vessels, etc. And in addition, MRI also helps us in planning the biopsy or surgery for the patient. Since bone cancer can spread to other parts of the body, we need PET CT scan, which is a single test which scans the whole body to look for disease anywhere else in the body. In addition, it helps us in assessment of response to chemotherapy treatment. The most important investigation in the diagnosis of bone cancers is biopsy, in which part of abnormal bone is taken and is sent for testing under the microscope by the pathologist. This process of taking abnormal bone can be done with the help of an open surgery, which requires incision and stitches and hence called open biopsy. However, a more convenient and patient-friendly way to obtain this abnormal tissue is with the help of a needle, and it's called needle biopsy. As compared to open biopsy, it has the advantage of avoiding any major incision, and hence patient has no or minimal pain. In addition, a needle biopsy can be done either as a daycare or an OPD procedure, and hence it avoids hospitalization. In addition, the most important benefit, which has an impact on oncological outcome as well, is that needle biopsy causes much less contamination of the normal tissue as compared to open biopsy. However, there are few myths associated with needle biopsy. Many people tend to confuse that FNAC and needle biopsy are same investigations, since both are done with the needle. But the fact is, FNAC and needle biopsy, they are two different investigations. And unlike many other cancers, FNAC has no role in the diagnosis of bone cancers. After the diagnosis has been made, the next question which comes to mind is that how do we treat bone cancers? Well, it depends on the type of bone cancer, whether it's primary or secondary. In primary bone cancers also, treatment depends on the type of primary bone cancer, whether it's osteosarcoma, Ewing sarcoma, chondrosarcoma, and so on, since each type behaves differently and hence is treated differently. In secondary bone cancers also, it depends on the origin of the disease, whether it has come from the breast, thyroid, lung, and so on, and also on the extent of the disease, whether it is unifocal, oligofocal, multifocal, that means whether it has involved only one bone, multiple bones, or whether it has involved other organs like liver, lung, etc. Osteosarcoma is the most common bone cancer in the adolescent age group. In this, a patient is subjected to chemotherapy for 2 to 3 cycles, followed by a surgery, and then again chemotherapy for 3 to 4 cycles. Similarly, in Ewing sarcoma, patient is given chemotherapy for 12 weeks, followed by local treatment in form of surgery and or radiation therapy, depending on the location of the tumor, response to chemotherapy, and so on, followed by chemotherapy for another 10 to 14 cycles. However, another primary bone cancer, chondrosarcoma, is treated only by a surgery. There is no role of chemotherapy or radiation therapy in the management of chondrosarcoma. Treatment of secondary bone cancers, as already discussed, depends on the origin of cancer and the extent of disease in the body. And a patient is subjected to surgery or radiation therapy or chemotherapy or combination, depending on case-to-case basis. However, the intent of treatment is palliative in majority of these patients, whereby we aim at improving the quality of life and life expectancy in patients with secondary bone cancers. Another big question is, what kind of surgery is performed in primary bone cancers? There is a common misconception among people that bone cancers can be treated only with amputation, that is, cutting the limb. However, this is completely wrong. In today's era, with the current surgical techniques, we can do a surgery in which we can just remove the cancerous bone, thereby saving the limb and hence its function. It's called limb salvage surgery. So, what exactly is limb salvage surgery? In limb salvage surgery, we remove the cancerous bone without cutting the limb, and the defect so created is reconstructed with artificial implant called as megaprosthesis. However, Some patients do not require megaprosthesis for reconstruction. In those patients, cancerous bone is removed and it's exposed to very high dose of radiation, which kills all the cancer cells, and sterilized bone so formed is reimplanted back to the parent bone. This process of reimplanting back the cancerous bone after sterilizing with high dose of radiation is called as ECRT technique, which stands for extracorporeal radiation therapy. You can watch out for results of this technique by clicking on the link above. Apart from radiation, even cryotherapy technique can be used to sterilize the cancerous bone. In this technique, the cancerous bone is removed and is dipped into liquid nitrogen, which has a temperature of minus 196 degrees centigrade. This low temperature kills all the cancerous cells, and the bone, once sterilized, is fixed back to the parent bone. This technique, which utilizes liquid nitrogen for sterilization of cancerous cells, is called cryotherapy technique. You can watch out the results of this technique by clicking on the link above. And now, coming to the most important question, is bone cancer curable? With the current chemotherapy regimens and surgical advances, bone cancer is curable in majority of the patients, provided the patient reaches a specialist on time. So, whom should one consult once diagnosed or suspected to have a bone cancer? Well, one should see a doctor who specializes in the management of bone and soft tissue cancers, and he is called orthopedic oncologist or musculoskeletal oncologist. I hope most of the queries related to bone cancers have been answered by now. For more information, you can log into our website www.curebonecancer.com. You can also follow us on our Facebook page, Bone Cancer Clinic. You can also WhatsApp your queries on 9903072264 or subscribe to our YouTube channel, link given above. Thank you.